Welcome back, everybody, to the Hearthstone Team Brawl here, presented by the all-new 2016 Honda Civic. My name is Frode, and I'm joined on the desk by TJ Osmitu Sanders, as well as Hafu from Cloud9. Unfortunately, Hafu, Cloud9 has been eliminated from the tournament, so yeah. But we get to have you on the desk, so it's kind of like a bittersweet moment for us, at least. How has the event been for you, though, taking a look back at everything?
It was super fun. It was exactly what I expected it to be. I mean, we had kind of that test run before, so I really enjoy this kind of format because you never get to really play Hearthstone with your friends, and you can all draft together and play together, and it affects each other, so it's pretty neat.
It's great, and I don't want to, you know, rummage too much through the past and the negative stuff, but if you could do one thing differently for this event, what would it have been?
I think it might have been more fun. I don't know if it's better for viewership, but definitely if we're trying to make this competitive, it'd be fun to see one pool, have everyone draft out of the same pool.
Oh, okay.
Because it feels a little silly.
Too crazy?
Yeah.
Too wild?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a good pun. Thank you, Hafu. Thank you. So yeah, we can definitely talk a little bit more about what's happened so far. For anybody just tuning in, we saw Cloud9 unfortunately be eliminated from the tournament, but that does mean Temple Storm stays alive, and they're going to be playing what we can call essentially the tiebreaker match. As you can see, Team Liquid is guaranteed advancement with a two-match win as well as a 12-game tiebreaker. Temple Storm versus Archon is about to commence. It almost doesn't really matter what their game differential is. It's about whoever wins the series.
Yeah, because it comes down to the tiebreaker. Basically, so whoever wins the match has the better match score, so it doesn't need to come down to that game score. So you know, this is going to be a pretty good matchup. We were talking about the strengths of their decks, and Tempo Storm has some pretty solid decks. Just in their first matchup of the day, they weren't able to make it work, but against Cloud9, it was just pretty brutal.
It was a little brutal.
Yeah. It was brutal.
A little brutal.
And I think Archon gets whiff of that. We were listening to them in the previous series that they were playing, and they said if Team Liquid barely beat Tempo Storm, and we're getting stomped at 7-2. I don't think we have a chance against Tempo Storm. So Archon's not feeling very confident, but then again, this is Hearthstone, this is a card game, and that's why it exists, right? You can definitely win even if you feel like you're unfavored.
Ooh.
Okay, so here we go. Game number one, or heat number one, rather. We're going to kick things off with what it looks like to be Firebat versus Amnesiac. Firebat on the Hunter, Amnesiac on the Druid. Firebat has been doing okay so far. I think Temple Storm has either been very convincing in their wins, or they seem to be floundering a lot. So not many super close games like we saw Archon versus Liquid.
I mean, Hunter is just a snowball class. If you get the board early, you just never care about trading again, and then you just go face and it's over. But if you lose the board, you have to trade to get back on the board, and that's pretty weak.
Definitely. And that, in fact, that's partially why I know a lot of people aren't really favorable to the class. Well, looks like Archon's pretty happy about an outcome. It looks like it was a King's Elec being able to draw what looks like to be Sludge Belcher, so that was a pretty big win there in the Joust.
Yeah, it's going to be tough, though. That Hunter deck's going up against Reynad's deck, which has been pretty successful. It sort of looks to be like a Reno-esque deck without the Reno. So it's got the high-value cards like Bran and those board sweeps. It just doesn't have the way to heal back up if it falls too far behind. So we'll check in on that match later.
All right, well, it seems like there's already a lot of expression of frustration from Temple Storm. I know this one means a lot, because it's not just Temple Storm versus Archon, but there's a lot of small rivalries in between. There's Amaz and Reynad, and then there's Firebat recently leaving the team and even joining forces with Temple Storm. So that's what makes this series all the more juicy, TJ.
Yeah. How many secrets did Firebat actually have from with that Mad Scientist?
I want to say three. I saw Dart and Explosive. Was it just
I didn't see a third secret, but I mean, I could be wrong. It's one of those things where there's a lot of lists, so it could have been snuck in at the last second when the timer ran out.
Right.
Yeah.
However, I do know that he has at least that dart and explosive trap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so, I mean, right now it's an interesting point where it looks like it's slowed down here on the main game stream. So let's go ahead and take a look at what Reynad and Zalay are up to, because it looks like he's...
Oh, he won the roll on that one. Sorry to cut you off.
Oh, he did. No worries.
Explosive trap there.
Explosive trap's pretty big.
Pretty
stop the board.
Huge.
Yeah, here's the other match. Of course, Reynad and Zalay, like Dan said. Getting the other spectate up so we can actually see the hand from Zalay. Zalay's Hunter deck did really well in their first matchup, but it struggled so much in the second matchup. And like Hafu was saying, if you get ahead, yeah, it's great. But if you get behind, you have to start trading. You fall too far behind in damage. And since your hero power doesn't affect the board, sometimes you just get burnt out and run out of cards.
I don't know if that's the one you want specifically, because Huffer trades very poorly into everything, forcing you to go aggressive and possibly hit the opponent phase. There is one more mana, though, so I'm anticipating perhaps one more mana to be squeezed in. If there's an Elven Archer, if there is a one mana taunt to complicate things like Goldshire Footman, you never know, but still, that's not what you're looking for.
No, I think you would have played it already if you did have any answer.
Yes, the next level read.
This is just kind of... I mean, he's definitely going to trade the 2-1 in the Fortuna's face, and then he's just unhappy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's usually the line of play I take almost every game that I roll Huffer like that.
And then it ends in unhappiness.
Mm-hmm. I would say Reyna got a really unlucky hand, but it kind of worked out for him because of the rolls in the game. So.
Yeah, ends up evening out in that department. And I guess, you know, is there a trend in Arena from your experience, Hafu? Like, for example, in Constructed, there's usually a huge advantage for Hunter over Warlock because the hero powers lining up. Is that the same case at all in your experience?
Yes and no, because actually Warlock minions tend to be so much stronger. It's a little bit hard to match up. I mean, there are really strong Hunter minions like High Main, for example.
Absolutely.
But, you know, there's also many, many weak ones that don't trade well. Or require a combo of some sort.
Mm-hmm. Like a beast on board.
Starving Buzzard or Houndmaster. And these kinds of cards are hard to fit in, and it requires you to kind of have something behind it. And even like Ram Wrangler, right?
I think he
does run a Ram Wrangler. I got Ram Wrangled.
Yeah.
And that was after a high main, but it requires you to have a beast first to be powerful.
Sure. So we're hopping back onto Firebat versus Amnesiac. I'm curious to see what the teams are talking about. Archon is extremely active with their comms. Let's go ahead and hop in and see what they have to say.
Right here.
Yeah. Play my explosive shot.
How do I play around an explosive shot?
Put it on the left side.
Yeah, you're right.
How do I play around a bag?
Alright.
You don't want to innervate ooze there?
No.
So, wait, I can golem here.
I have mines. I have the lumber in my deck, yeah.
I don't know what to do this turn.
I can golem and just kill this.
That's fine. He doesn't have many cards in hand. Yeah. Getting one of these 6/6s out isn't terrible.
Yeah.
Okay.
Dude, 6/6 is good there.
Not really.
6/6 is perfect there. It's actually really good.
How's this? He just does this. It's not perfect.
No, it doesn't matter. I mean, you have 2/6s. What else is better there in the move?
I don't know. I can just like play a bunch of
this
shit.
I have to make this attack.
No. This is fillers for your 5/2. So you have 5/2 next turn, 6/2 next turn. Right? I mean, Arena is really tempo based.
I'm gonna play the ooze.
I think you play
just
the ooze
like
too.
On board, this kind of sucks.
I might even do this.
No.
It's worth considering.
No. You have so many high cards.
Yeah, I guess.
Oh, this polymorph is pretty sick.
Waker coin polymorph, right?
Oh my goodness.
Do I want to just keep the Waker?
There's going to be a big punish in about three. Oh, well, hold on.
You first have to look at the discover here. I would have gone Web Spinner. I don't know where he's going to go. Oh, no, Tall Strider. Because then you just 4/4.
I think he wants the power shot as well.
This is insane.
So this ends up being a thing where Fireback can go for a big punish, and Amnesiac is not happy to see that. So that's a big swing on the board. Amnesiac's stuck with an innervate, so he needs to pair that together with something, and that's something.
Yeah. It's kind of funny they were talking about playing around explosive shot.
Right.
The power shot's just like a mini explosive shot. You don't really think of the power shot when you're thinking about playing around things.
It's a newer card.
Yeah,
for sure. And that means that this looks to be like a very clean way to remove, both with the Houndmaster and with a second Tomb Spider so you can pick up value, although it is weaker on the board. I mean, it's one of those things where, in this situation, do you value more tempo or do you value getting the Tomb Spider for more options?
Honestly, a Tomb Spider is going to affect how you play your turn next turn, right? Like, they're going to stay as 4 drops, but depending on what you draw, you'll play the next turn quite differently. So I think it's fine to drop the Tomb Spider now.
Okay.
Oh, man.
Oh, wow. My God.
That's rough.
That is pretty nutty. The game.
Yeah.
We'll see. I mean, I don't know what's in the Druid deck, but we've seen some pretty wild cards.
He has a lot of taunts. I mean, I think he has 2 lumbers, and I don't think we've seen one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, hey.
Speaking of, nice call.
I mean, that is a volcanic lumber, and with the hero power, allows you to efficiently use it. But again, Innervate's kind of sitting there, not really doing anything, but I guess we'll have to find out if that's going to be good enough. Let's go ahead and switch. Looks like Reyna's in a very complicated board state as well, hopping into his match against the Hunter.
Wow, they're both still at 30 health. That's
this late in the game is pretty unlikely, right?
Hunter versus Warlock. Well, The refreshment bender helped a lot there. So
small little sequence error from Reyna, but not the end of the world. So he could have gained one health, which sometimes makes a difference. You never know.
Huge Toad went on the right target. That's a plus.
Oh my. The Argus is going to be pretty huge on the Echoing Ooze and the Egg.
Yeah, that's right. Although I guess, you know, we've been seeing Reyna actually drop Chromagus very often, and sometimes it gets like some ridiculous things. I think, I don't know if it was against you.
I saw a lot of Flame Imps.
It was,
against
he one time got two BGHs off the top. He tapped into it, and it was just like the most amazing value.
He also got the Dark Peddlers as well, which is like so much value. You get Dark Peddler for Chromagus and then get two one drops.
Is that above or below average for
the
Jungle
Moonkin? I think
it's
above, actually.
Yeah?
Because a 4-4 is fine.
Sure.
Like, how many beasts are bigger than a 4-4 compared to, like, the little ones, right? You have...
Sure.
Oh, Demon but that's Wrath. Not what he wants right now with the Spell Tower. Oh, my gosh.
Oh my god, you're right. It's I forgot.
It's four.
A great draw.
It's a 3-mana demon exclusive flame strike.
That's
followed by a Frost Warlord.
And then into a Chromagus on a board state that favors Reynad, which is just nuts.
Oh my god. Dang, that is pretty hard pill to swallow if you're Zalay here in this position. Let's go ahead and listen to the Temple Storm team comms and check in with how they're doing.
I think you hero power. If you think over two turns,
go all in.
It's only better to play the dude if he plays a massive dude. If he does, it's only better to play the dude if he plays a massive dude. And if he plays a massive dude, you're dead. Yeah.
Do you guys think I go all in?
Taking a look at Eloise POV here.
I can't save this.
I don't know. That's a... depending on how you feel about how the game's been going question.
Yeah, I think so. I think you do it because, yeah, that way your Zap-O-Matic can attack.
Yeah, I will play this at least.
Yep.
I'm not sure about this.
Play it.
Okay.
Yeah, if you're going to play one, you got to play both, right?
Yeah.
Because, like, your reload of being a 3-3 isn't really going to make a difference at the end of the day.
Yeah.
It's just the amount of cards he has in his hand. So I like this, putting him on Have It or Bust.
This too?
Yeah, that combo is disgusting.
Do I tap?
You can even buff the 6/6 up for the trade. You're at 29, point. So there's no reason not to tap, right?
Yeah. Well, unless I'm doing these two, you know.
Yeah, and then you do Echoing Ooze on the far left, and then you Argus that and the 6/6.
Checking out
six,
Fire Bat versus
trade. Just let him trade.
I don't know. I think you just trade your 7/7 into a 6/6 and win on value at the end of the day. Like, I don't think you need to take any risks. No, you buff it with Argus first, right?
Well, don't I want to buff this with Argus? Then Creeper's like a blank for a turn.
Okay. Then you want to just trade the 6/6 off completely?
I was thinking buff this and Ooze.
Sure, I like that as well, yeah. And then just trade the 6/6s.
No, go face.
All right.
I want to trade 6/6.
The only
trade
way you
sixes
lose
is, good.
Is going face, right? Because you win on card advantage with your hero power. But
you think I should?
I think you should trade. I think at the end of the day, you just have value and win.
Yeah, right.
7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
I'm going to
Man,
try.
With the buffs and misses, that Warlock's been able to get so much mileage off the life tap.
Yeah.
Extremely good game so far, outcome for Reynad. And it looks like a couple other games are coming to a close. What do you see, Hafu?
I mean, I don't think Zalay can beat Reynad from this board state. I can't even think of a sequence of cards for him.
Mm-hmm. Usually requires a lot of AoE to come back from that spot, like Explosive Trap, with a combination of Unleashed Hounds, because so many things were at 3 health. Or, you know, speaking of which, looking at an impact of having like an AoE like Unleashed Hounds, there's so many small minions that have life, but it's very threatening. You know, actually, Thermal Plug here ends up being able to help control a little bit of the board state.
So he's going for the spare part? Oh, he got the freeze. Oh, he already had the freeze.
He had the freeze earlier, yeah. But Eloise actually gets the finicky cloak field, so that's going to help.
That's really huge.
And wow.
Still at 30 health, so doesn't really need a reload, just needs to get in that 3 damage now.
And push.
I mean, I think that's going to be the win condition. Now, they do have to factor in that there was another spare part, so there could be a Rusty Horns, but I don't think that even matters. I don't think you can play around the potential of a Rusty Horn, because Yeah, I mean, at this stage, it's all or nothing. There's no cards left for the Shaman.
Sure. One thing that you have to consider is if they had Flamestrike, would they have already played it? Because a lot of people might think, well, you know, you want to play the Finicky Cloakfield on your highest target, but, you know, you have to really weigh in a lot of decisions of the outcomes of the game. And looks like they end up going for the 7-5. It's perfectly reasonable, but something you want to consider as well. That Healing Totem is a big difference maker as well.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I mean, even with AoE, it still wins. Oh, and yep. That game is over.
Yep, Chromag's the victory cigar, just signifying that I won anyways, and this was the card I had. Something that Reyna's debating.
Blizzard!
That's a
we
really
didn't think
big
about
card.
Blizzard.
Yeah, Blizzard or Frost Nova or something like that.
Well, that is...
That's exactly the card. And you know what?
Might be enough.
Leper Gnomes are going to continue to swing back.
And that's an Ardric Commander too, right? That six drop that's upside down. So that's another comeback tool. The Finicky Cloakfield's going to wear off, and that'll be able to trade in next turn once it's unfrozen. So.
What is that first card?
It's a Draconid Crusher.
Oh, it's a Crusher. Okay, I've never seen the golden version.
No worries.
I only see the arena version.
Is...
Especially upside down golden version.
Yeah, upside down golden. Guess the card, right?
Is that a board full of Leper Gnomes? I think that's a board full of Leper Gnomes. I think you're looking for
11, 13,
something.
15, 17, 17, 25, 27, 28 damage.
Whoa. Silence is not even enough because it actually removes the buff on the target. You need something that does exactly 4 damage off the top here.
That is
what
not
a steal.
It.
Wow.
This is just a Moz.
That's insane.
You know?
Yeah.
We were talking earlier, and I just think a Moz is actually luckier than most other human beings. Some people are
it's
luckier.
So funny.
Overall, right? Like, if you roll a million dice in your life, mm-hmm. I think he wins more than the average human.
All right, well, you know, I mean, Amaz is staying true to his roots, at least. That's what he was known for in the very beginning, mm-hmm. being able to be very fortunate in some of these ridiculous situations. In that case, Blizzard, I think, was his best card by a mile, because even if you have, like, something like Frost Nova, Blizzard killed so many minions for Leper Gnomes to threaten damage, so really good stuff overall, and I think we have to do a score check here, TJ. What was the final result of the first heat?
I believe Amaz was the only player from Archon to take a win, so 2-1 in favor of Tempo Storm, and it was very close to a 3-0, though, and that's pretty dangerous.
That was a steal.
Yeah, definitely
That was definitely a steal.
It's a huge one, too, because being down 0-3, makes your chances so much smaller than the 2-1 split, because you can always take another 2-1 split, sending it to the final
heat. Need to get to 5 wins, right?
Yep.
So
5 is the magic number for this series, because, again, if whoever wins the series goes to the finals. It doesn't matter about your game breaker at all.
Yeah.
Because that order, match score, then mm-hmm. game score. It's looking rough. Tempo Storm has some pretty solid decks. I don't think they match up that well against Team Liquid, but if they make it to the finals, it's a fresh start.
That's
they get
right.
fresh drafts, so they don't have to worry about that dog deck that just, oh man.
He has to do it again.
I haven't even seen it.
Oh,
gosh, you're right. they're better ones.
Well, I mean, at this stage, it kind of doesn't matter because Team Liquid will be redrafting anyways, but it was very close to a modern-day Oil Rogue in Constructed, we'll say.
Yeah.
Going to heat number 2, we have a couple of interesting matchups. My personal favorite is the one you see on your screen, Reynad versus Amaz. And Amaz is going to be on that mage deck, which he just was able to steal a game from Eloise. Meantime, Reynad's still playing that zoo-like warlock. And then we also have some good old hunter mirrors, as well as a druid versus shaman.
Yeah, this is the match on the screen, the one that I've been looking forward to all day. This warlock deck from Reynad. It actually looks pretty strong, but there have been some situations where he's been unfortunate, whereas Amaz is like the opposite. The deck looks weird, but he just steals wins from nowhere.
That's because I was talking to them after our match, and they said that Amaz just took the worst deck. Basically, they constructed the other two first, and he got all the leftovers, minus the 2 zombie chows. Because his deck was so bad, he's like, at least if I lose the early game, there's no chance of winning. And unfortunately for him, he's losing the early game. Although, he has both Acolyte and Sheep to follow up, so it's not the worst, but it's not what you want to see from your zombie chow.
Also, Reyna doesn't have a turn 3 play outside of removal, so if Amaz played it a little bit slow...
Yet.
There's always the hope that you'll top deck. A very common fallacy amongst all Hearthstone players.
Unfortunately for Amaz, he gave him something to do now.
Otherwise, he would have done nothing. And, you know, in some ways, it's like because he has a suboptimal play, it ends up being much better for him. And now it's a pretty decent curve for Reynad going to the following turns. And Amaz gave up his coin when he just picked a Flame Waker. Very
Feels
brutal
bad,
indeed.
Man.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you just Spellslinger here and just hope for the best. Because you just have to, like, I don't think you can just ping, and you definitely can't just play an Explosive Sheep on this board.
have to just hope that you get some cheap spells to sort of come back on the board with
Honestly,
the Flame Waker.
I might even just Flame Waker here. Because how do you win this game? I think that's always the best question to ask is how do I win from this this position?
And how would you imagine winning from this position then if you're a monk?
He can't remove the Flame Waker and then him playing Unstable Portal kills the 2-1 and the 1-1 and then he has some miracle way of dealing with the 4-drop.
Spellslinger can do some amazing things, so.
And some terrible things, too.
Yeah, that's very true.
I wonder if he's also worrying about being super defensive because he can play Explosive Feet next turn and then finally have ways to activate more Flame Waker spells. So that does come into the play as time goes on.
Humility. He can humility his own egg, right?
Oh, yeah, sure. That's very cute.
I don't think Raynan needs it. He has so many activators in this deck that I saw already.
It's a Whirling Blades in that case.
Mm. Well, most of the time you want to use humility to get you some really good tempo trades.
Yeah.
It's pretty much the exact power of Aldor Peacekeeper. The only benefit is that you can do it on your own minions as well.
And it's a warlock, so you don't have to worry about giving up that card like a paladin where they don't have tap to replenish their resources. So.
True. Well, I mean, you get that for free.
For free.
Another zombie chow. I mean, if the unwanted cards are zombie chows, I'm all for it. if I'm in Maz's seat. Maz got lots of decisions. Let's go ahead and listen to T-Mark on here because there's interesting plays available for both sides.
Trade 6 now.
No, trade makes sense.
Flame Juggler. Let's think about the better way to do this. I guess I'll trade here and see what I get. I could get Stone Tusk Boar.
Trade it first. Yeah, sure. I like it. Boar. It's fine. If you never lose the board. Okay, and now you have to trade Flame Juggler. Right?
Well, 50-50
this way,
66%.
Yeah, makes sense.
Well, it's more of a hedge to just do it first.
No,
right?
You just do it first.
Let's see if we can take a look at the Shaman versus Druid matchup that they're talking about.
Oh, perfect.
Wow. Nice.
That's pretty good.
The right, Flame Juggler hit the right target. I believe it was
just
a 5-1.
Dragon's Breath this, right?
Oh man, that was a big deal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Alright, we gotta pray that there's no fire, Ellie.
Yeah. Alright, what do we do here? Kodo is pretty good. He's not gonna kill it. He's just gonna go face. So this is otherwise explosive.
Oh my god, stop playing beefy stuff. I mean, I don't taunt it.
Sorry.
So I just charge.
Yeah. Okay. Let's go back. Oh, it's right over here. So if you look right now, Raynan's also in a very interesting spot where he can choose to play like these smaller minions here. Like, what's the best sequencing, do you think?
Well, it's turn 5 mage. I would have just played the 1-4, which is what he does, so now it looks kind of silly. Yeah. But, I mean, I don't think he can wait for the turn 6 Floating Watcher 3-2. You need to establish the board now. And also, these cards kind of get weaker as we near Flamestrike turn. And, I mean, they didn't see a Flamestrike, but they did see a Blizzard. And you can just assume. I mean, there's always a threat of Flamestrike.
Yeah.
So getting these minions out now and kind of forcing his hand is nicer.
They've only played the one heat against Archon. So they've only seen that Blizzard from Amaz's Mage deck. So they can't pinpoint it. But, of course, it's a common. So just as likely as it is in Arena, it's probably even more likely in this format, just because you're able to pick from an entire pool.
I actually think AoEs are pretty uncommon from what I saw, because there's not enough basic and classic decks, and I was seeing maybe like one AoE, maybe two AoE at the most per each of our classes.
Right, and then even the new expansion, they don't release many. There's like, Priest has like Excavated Evil, for example.
Right.
What else outside of that? Well, that was Tides' only AoE was the Excavated Evil. He didn't get a Holy Nova, he didn't get a Light Bomb, which Light Bomb's super rare, so.
That's an epic, yeah.
Yeah, it's an epic, and how many packs for, what was it, GBG that Light Bomb came in?
Not too sure.
I don't remember. It wasn't too many, so that was pretty rare. But yeah, that's true, Flamestrike. You weren't given many of those basic packs.
But yeah, as time goes on, Hearthstone is releasing more and more minions and less removal.
Yeah.
And so now we see minion fights more, which is why when they do have AoE, like we saw that Power Shot last game, just clear off 3 minions, and that was it.
Yeah.
That was it.
Yep. All right, well, Raynan just got his board cleared and declared to the world that he's an idiot, but you know, we're looking for new. Ooh! Oh man, that was much more satisfying than the burn that I was about to drop on Raynan.
I think just double two is fine.
It is. Yeah. It's just cool because how often do you get to see Elise Starseeker actually be able to trigger in this kind of scenario? Very rarely.
Oh, those are some bad ones.
Yeah. Well, Voidwalker can have potential. You can block. You can, like, protect an important creature.
Playing it right now might be even better than the egg, right? Because it forces a 2-3 to trade in any pings, and it uses two of his mana if he wants to get through.
Yeah.
And then your 2-2 trades with a 2-2. Whereas the other way, yeah. So I think this is actually better just for board state. Whereas we can only hope for the best, and we can only hope that the board has to trade with the board and just the hero power. But, I mean, obviously we know he has a bit more than that.
It's true. However, it's not like Amaz has overwhelming board pressure at this state.
A zombie chow on turn 6? You don't think so?
Nope. Not at all. I dare say that a zombie chow is kind of bad.
I think he should have hit in. I don't really understand why you would hold back on that. Like on the zombie chow?
He does have Blizzard. He might be thinking that, you know, that damage is going to get done anyway.
Oh, so trying not to get him. That's a very good point.
Floating Watcher is an opportunity to get triggered here. Your hero power turns into a 6-6, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So then your opponent has to deal with it with Fireball or some other capacity.
Ooh.
That's a good draw.
Yeah.
Demon Wrath is an excellent card. We talked about AoEs. Rana has several of them here.
I think he has the three main ones. He has Demon Wrath, Hellfire, and Shadow Flame in his deck. So
just needs Twisting Nether for the complete wombo here.
Do you
the
quadfecta. Flamewaker, Commanding Shout.
Flamewaker Commanding Shout. That is interesting. You have potential for clearing.
Right.
I like it. Not to mention that if you need to trade with the Junior, for example, it won't die.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man. Is he really okay? I was like, there's no way he doesn't possible, right?
Right. It's too risky. I think you don't want to give it up. You know what? Flamewaker sometimes just doesn't obey you.
Finally got the Power of Alarming for the egg, but. Yeah.
Probably a much better activator than Humility for the Nerubian Egg.
By the way, it looks as if Eloise is about to close in on Amnesiac here. What a dominant board position with the Mooklis Champion.
Yeah, oh my goodness. That Mooklis Champion actually won her quite a few games.
Yeah, I know, and they were debating whether to put it into the deck at all in the first place. Firebat was like, I don't know about Inspire Minions, but Rana's like, no, this Inspire Minion is bananas. Wow, that's another big win here for Tempo Storm as they're climbing up. They're ahead, so every game that they win, they will get closer to advancing through. Do we know who won between Zalay and Firebat? Because it looks like Firebat was able to take the victory in that Hunter Mirror.
Four.
Yeah. So they're Tempo Storm's actually one game away from getting that magic number 5. So if Raynad is able to take this,
then that's it.
That's it.
The series is over.
Wow.
So Amaz is the last form of defense here for Archon.
And it's actually looking okay for Amaz, I think, so.
Yeah, the hand quality from Raynad's not that great. He can tap, you know, into more stuff.
And he can find the golden monkey.
He hasn't even put the golden monkey in yet, though.
Nah.
Ah, there we go.
It's
a cycle.
Golden monkey actually might not even be that great. Because then he gives up the AoE tools. He probably gives up his comeback mechanics.
Well, I mean, we'll see how things go. First, he has to draw it.
Unless he gets Deathwing, but as we saw from Hafu's Paladin deck, you didn't even get a chance to use that card.
No. Nope.
Do you regret putting that in?
No, I think it was correct, but I think the deck just struggled early game. I think all of our decks struggled early.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, something that was definitely part of the strategy for Tempo Storm. Which, by the way, looks like they're discussing a lot of it, so I kind of want to hear what they're saying specifically about these 5 remaining mana crystals.
I don't know. You were ignoring the Flamewaker, right, and just hoping he doesn't have spells.
Yeah.
So that goes into the 4-2, and then
do I use this? No, I can't. I can. I can do this on that.
Yeah, Humility on the 3-4th, I think, is fine. If he plays a big thing, we have Power of Whelming to blow through it anyway, hopefully. That's why we're trying to develop, a spam amount of dudes here. So I like that. We just really hope he doesn't have Arcane Intellect or something, because that'll just tear us apart.
Ends the game.
Oh, he has Arcane Intellect.
Yeah. Well, we're hoping he doesn't have it in his hand. Uh-huh. Yeah. I mean, if he has a bunch of spells go with his Flamewaker, we're toast. But the amount of spells in this format's pretty limiting. All right.
I agree.
That's the game.
Well, we're one damage off being able to kill that.
We got a million buffs, and the Hunter of Large Game.
The Hunter of Large Game. Okay.
Oh, there we go. That's enough, right?
Yeah.
You buff something and just trade one thing into it. And so the one thing we trade should be the Mystic, right? Or the 1-3, it heals us to full health.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we do that. Power overwhelming it and brand Lance Carrier it. Or do we need to brand?
We don't need to brand.
So, wait. Yeah, 5, 6, 7. So we can hold back the brand and develop Imp Gang Boss instead if we want?
That's probably right.
Yeah, yeah. It's definitely right. Imp Gang Boss is crazy on this board. So we Lance Carrier, PO, develop the Imp Gang Boss.
Oh, why that one?
Build a full health.
Oh, that's why.
How does this work? Okay, the good way.
Yeah. Yeah, now we trade this. All right, we're coming back in the blue. Our hero power should help us win.
He needs to not have, like, another big minion.
Big minion or AI.
If he does, it needs to be really big, and I need to draw
the hunter of big game.
Yeah. That's pretty good.
All right, all right.
It was really big.
I can kill it twice. That game's pretty large.
Okay. We can make our own large game.
Ooh, that's terrible.
Terrible, but it's great next turn. So we could play Brand and the Battlecry goes off twice.
I trade first.
Trade first and then the Battlecry goes off twice. You make the biggest minion.
Position.
Make bigger game than his game.
I always got the biggest game. What's that?
Put on the right.
You're right, yeah. I should have put it on the right.
Oh, God.
Oh, the top
tech
master.
I hope he doesn't draw his polymorph. He has one, right?
But we have Argus. He has one. He has
and
one
he has
polymorph.
Blizzard. Like, yeah, he's getting close to the point where he could just, like, Blizzard and then punch you in the face twice.
Uh-huh.
It gets scary.
Need to peel. It's just going to be Jungle Panther by the time I draw it.
Yeah.
Or I'll be dead. One of those two things will happen.
Well, if we don't draw it off the top next turn, we're probably trading in Chromagus tapping.
Yeah.
Going to super tap.
So he's probably thinking about killing Bran or the 10-10.
Let's listen to Archon as well, because I think they got some interesting plays.
Nice.
We put him to 17. We have two off. They can't life tap then, because we can polymorph the taunt. I actually like that a lot.
It's Gnomish Blizzard?
It's kind of ambitious.
Yeah, try it.
Let's try to start with Gnomish. I like starting with Gnomish.
That's
more
really
burn. I think you do it. I think you just Blizzard.
Yeah.
Blizzard, go face. All right.
Yeah, I like that.
Okay.
Like, he's not going to skip life tap here. There's no way. With two cards in hand, how good would his two cards have to be?
Oh, we play that and don't tap, right? We just play that and not tap.
What are we looking for? We don't
BGH.
Look for anything.
It's one and...
But...
I could tap and...
Have we seen a fireball yet? Because we're dead to fireball, and if we tap...
I forgot.
Are we dead to Dragon's Breath? If we tap, we're dead to Dragon's
he
Breath.
Has
We've
dragon
seen
breath.
Dragon's Breath. Uh-huh. I think he's trying to make us tap and then kill us with Dragon's Breath.
But we have no healing.
This
if he just goes face
enough.
Dragon's Breath us, we're dead in like two turns.
We kill him on the backswing of this. Look at how much damage we have.
No, we don't.
The Frostwolf Warlord's another
10-10. Oh, yeah, it happens twice. Yeah.
We have two 10-10s in play, so we would kill him.
This board is strong enough.
So... We're playing around Dragon's Breath by not tapping. I haven't seen Fireball. We've seen Dragon's Breath twice.
Well, missiles could kill him.
Yeah, I have two go to the face.
Two
right?
go to the face. That's kind of crazy.
You could poly first, then missiles.
Yeah,
I don't think that's
first,
that bad. So like, I think you're going to poly this turn. I think missiles ping goal and put him to two is always fine here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let's poly the 12-12 and then... All right.
Missiles.
Game time, missiles.
Okay.
Oh! That's fine. You can put him to
pretty
one
pretty good.
Now.
I'm putting him to one.
Yep.
Because
sure.
he can tap.
Yep.
Wait, how close are we to dead?
No, it doesn't matter.
He needs eight.
It doesn't fucking matter.
Okay.
Well, we would have died if we tapped, so it's good we didn't tap.
No,
right?
We wouldn't. We would have drawn BGH.
If we top deck BGH, then I guess so. We have.
Right
that
on
gives
time.
Us four?
Right on time.
So 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 damage. Wow. We were really close, huh?
Were we? I don't think we're close at all. And that's only four, so we only would have
gotten... Yeah, it's only 14, but I mean, like...
16. Yeah.
So if we would have tapped last turn, then we couldn't have played it and the 5 drop. Oh, the BGH is right there! So we would have tapped into
Argus. That wraps up game, or heat number two. I keep making that mistake, TJ. My apologies. Very entertaining, based off the way that the conversations are happening, based off what they're playing around, percentages. I really like some of the reads, though, by both teams here. You know, Firebat saying playing around Dragon's Breath, which is effectively the same thing, the Arcane.
As Arcane
so
God.
Really on point, Templestorm, as well as Archon being able to stay alive. Huge win for them.
Yeah, if they 3-0 the last heat, then they That's make it out, at least they stay alive, because right now Tempo Storm has 4 wins, the magic number, of course, being 5. So they need a 3-0, though, and Amaz is the only player on their team so far in this match to take games.
That's right.
He's 2-0, and the
and
other players are 0-2.
He has the worst deck, according to what they say. I mean,
That's true.
You never
we
know
thought
if Strife
had the best deck and went 0-6, so.
Oh, no. Strife Pro.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Zalay is also on a 5-game losing streak. So eventually, Variance will probably swing in your way, assuming it goes that way. So if Zalay loses another one, he also will be 0-6 based off the most recent results.
Yeah.
Little game of musical chairs as we get ready for the last match, the one that I'm excited about because we're about to see Firebat start off with against Amaz. And that's going to be happening to start things off on the featured stream.
Firebat versus Amaz. So both of these players so far in this match are 2-0. So already going into that, just by the match alone, we have ourselves a good match. That doesn't even include all the recent stuff that's happened between, you know, Archon and Firebat leaving the team. So high stakes for this match.
Again, Tempo Storm has to win 1 out of 3 games. Archon has to win every single one, and that's going to be tough. In the meantime, I believe we're going to have a couple of other pairings as well. Eloise is on the Shaman. She is going to be playing up against Lay. And Amnesiac will be playing against Raynad. So as long as Amaz and Co. don't drop a game, they're through to the finals. But that is a tough order.
That is a tough hand.
Yeah, Firebat has an early curve with Mad Scientist and Eagle Horn Bow.
Is this constructed? Hello?
I mean, for a while, tracking used to be running constructed. But, I mean, Amaz has turn one play. At least he has a turn one play. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my.
And they run two traps, right? This is...
Yes, I start believe trap so. And explosives.
Assuming they don't draw it, but that's something that's pretty appetizing. You're going to try to trade into it, play something else. But Amaz skips turn two. That is terrible. And that's going to give complete initiative to Firebat.
No dart traps, so it's explosive.
Oh!
Oh.
That's brutal. Well, I mean, it's not that bad.
That's not that bad, is it?
Does that incentivize you to just develop a Kungus? Yeah. Or are you going to play Ooze anyways? Because it's not obvious at all.
I kind of like scaring them with the scientist.
Oh, yeah.
That's just me. I don't know if there's any more synergies in the deck with Echoing Ooze, so that's really up to, like, I don't know his deck well enough.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Wow. I mean, he's going to play the Flame Waker, but it's going to get so punished by the Eagle Horn and the Ooze. This is kind of hard to watch.
Is there a world where you're afraid of Snipe?
No, because you haven't seen it in the other games, I think we've seen enough secrets.
That's an excellent point. I love that you brought it up there, because these guys have been passing information back and forth, and it's very useful, but, I mean, now that they should know the traps that are available, right?
Yeah, I think he knows. Like, we didn't even see it's explosive, but I believe that's explosive.
Yeah, the 100 decks were, the 100 games were played pretty quickly, so we haven't got to showcase them in this match so far, but, again, the players talk with each other, they discuss,
they know. On the other match, Eloise versus Zalay. Eloise got a pint size on turn 2, and that is not a huffer. So
no, it's not.
She's actually going to get a turn 3 Senjin with... Oh, no! Turn 3 for...
Yeah, let's go ahead and hop over to Eloise versus Zalay, and you're about to see Zalay get completely out-tempoed here based off so many options.
I think you would just Senjin and then go for the Trog Fire Guard. Oh, no, you
can't
still
play the
can't
trog.
Do that, huh?
Yeah.
You still can't do that next
turn. If Emperor Thorsen was a 2-mana 2-2, then yeah, absolutely, we would go for that. But
well, then I'd probably just do Senjin into Fire Guard, protect the pint size for an extra turn.
It's true. I do like it because of the overload. Even though you do buff it in the end, it's just like one of those things that ends up sabotaging you more than anything. But I mean, Shaman's one of those classes that was slept on, you know? But I know it's a class that can perform pretty decently if given the right cards.
I mean, I think all the classes can perform decently. Mm-hmm. We see all of them played and constructed, correct? I don't actually play too much constructed. But I think it's a little bit more... Maybe not at the top balanced, but overall you can still probably climb to Legend with any class.
Yeah,
I agree. I think a lot of classes that people perceive to be at the bottom are very underrated. You know, people look at Hunter, for example, being not played very often in both Arena and Constructed. However, Hunter still always is just there as, like, whenever you least expect it, just kind of beats you and you're not, you know, you're just like, why did I lose to Hunter? It's not even that good.
Yeah, like... Aggro Hunter right now has some good matchups in Constructed, but the deck from Eloise, it's performed well, but it has some weaknesses. It doesn't have too much, like, reload. The Ancestral Knowledge is, I think, like, the only piece of card draw that she has. So the games that she's lost, we've seen her basically just run out of steam. Her board gets cleared by AoE or just by like favorable trades, and then she doesn't draw into the spells that she needs to get her hand back. But right now, she's got great, you know, creatures,
sure.
And then the ancestral knowledge to reload. So she looks like she's in a good spot.
All right, going back to Firebat versus Maz here. Maz is back with in a turn where he's got a lot of decisions to make because of those secrets. Ends up going for a Blizzard to clear the board. No third secret, okay. So at least that we know of. Maybe there's copies.
Yeah, that could be true.
I think one way to judge how strong a deck is based off of how many class cards there are. Mm-hmm. And I say this about Arena, but you can kind of see it here too. When we look at some of the hands, you'll just see it's all class cards.
Yeah.
And some of the decks, like Amaz, might think is a bit weaker because he has a lot of neutrals. Granted, some of the neutrals are very strong, right? Like Arctic Commander is a top tier. You can say that's on par with a class card. But some, I'd say, aren't. And
interesting.
It's hard to beat class card after class card if you're playing neutral after neutral.
Right, yeah. And the reason for that is because a lot of times class cards are stat a little bit above the normal, mm-hmm. so therefore they just perform slightly better, and that kind of snowballs as the board continues to grow. In fact, I kind of want to listen to what Tempo Storm and Archon are saying. Let's start with Tempo Storm first.
He can't use his hero power while that bow's in play for the rest of the game.
Yeah, I guess I'll save it. I don't know.
Do you think I trade with this and play all these if you haven't got Trap or Unleash?
Yeah, I like it.
Like it.
Mm. That seems really greedy. Maybe the 3-2. The 3-2 trades in, play a bunch of dudes. Don't be overly.
Because he's going to kill this anyways, right?
I think you just play Crusher and Chao.
He's going to kill the Chao? Yeah, I guess so, maybe.
I think it's fine.
Yeah,
because you have Commander next turn, right? You can just create tension here. I could take 13 next turn.
You want to Shadow Flame?
I want to do this, and tap, and just pass.
Well, I don't want you to take too much damage. I think it's a very good Shadow Flame turn.
It's very weak.
Okay, whatever.
Are you sure?
I didn't really look at it.
I could attack here, save 3 life. I'll do it.
You will do it. Let him know, man.
That's right. We can see who wears the pants on that team.
Not you should, you will.
I like it. The power of Eloise compels you. Yeah, Firebat looks like he took the Tomb Spider off that tracking, which was a decision we were thinking about what was going to happen. And, you know, there's some interesting choices. Mothless Champion's one of those, the longer the game goes and the board it sticks on the board, the harder it comes for Mage to deal with, so I don't mind it.
Yeah, they had the option to get Houndmaster out of it as well, but they didn't have many resources in their hand. They only had 2 cards, I think, so being able to chain Tomb Spiders allows you to, you know, make your hand go a little bit further than it otherwise would.
Yeah, but Firebat's running out of steam.
He is.
It's kind of crazy because we saw at the beginning, Amaz's hand just didn't seem promising at all. Whereas
every game.
Well, it's one of those things where he had more power as the game developed. If he could get to that point, we were wondering if Hunter could stabilize the board.
Although this is
I mean,
turn 10.
Yeah, it is coming up on the opportunity for you to use Mukla.
I mean, he did just play 4-2 and 3-2 into explosive as well. Oh my.
Is King Crush...
Is it a debate at all, Hafu?
No, it's got King Crush, right? You just do it.
Oh, yeah.
You just do it next turn.
I like it.
Just
and then,
do it.
I mean, does that make you start playing very aggressive because you have Crush?
Yeah, I mean, you already have a combo with Unleash and Dogs or Unleash and Mukla's and Hero Power. I don't think you ever want to play all three. So I would just Hero Power here and pass and wait. Because, I mean, you're not threatened by anything because you have Dart Trap and Explosive Trap still.
Sure.
So, I mean, even though not much has happened, you know, the Dart and Explosive were played, what, 5 turns ago?
Sure.
Yeah, and Amaz is going to be the one trading anyway because he doesn't want to go face. So.
But this is...
Okay. Well, we just got information, by the way, that Eloise was able to close out the game against Soleil, which means Tempo Storm is guaranteed to go through. But there's a lot of pride on the line here because Amaz still trying to climb back from his early deficit against Firebat, and looks like he has done it for now, but he's doing a very annoying job of just not attacking. There it is, King Crush. To the face.
I don't think there's any other choice there.
I like it.
Yeah.
Based off what Hafu was saying in the previous turn, I kind of want to see what Amaz is going to talk about and how he reacts to this.
You know he's going to be the one doing the trading anyway, so.
Oh.
What?
Are you holding a dragon?
No, no.
No dragon.
Okay. Can you draw a dragon?
No. You get spell splinger into East Quarter.
Without
dragons.
Dragon. Without a dragon.
Did he get that off spider? Is that in his deck?
Got that tomb spider.
So can we, like, cool it and set up lethal or something?
Very likely.
No.
Very likely, yeah.
We can cool it and play an 8-4. 8-4 hits really hard.
8-4 hits really hard.
Oh my god. Do not fuck me right now, Peddler. Did you really get Coil? You really have PO?
I don't want to play Spell Slinger.
Ripped Coil?
So, like, we go face to proc the trap.
Oh my god. Shadow Bolt, and then you just rip Coil. Rend. Okay, sure, dude. I mean, you didn't need to get luckier, right?
Dang, man. 15-year-old coming over after the assault.
I was supposed to Spell Slinger first, but okay.
Suspect. I don't want
to. Hero power.
Yeah, the dart trap could kill him. But he knows that's what it is, right? Yeah.
Oh, again.
Get some owl.
I was being wrecked by this so much.
Unstable portals that, but doesn't have the dragon. Alright.
It's a legendary club.
So, we can give him all of the leper gnomes in the world.
That you can, Raynad.
So I have 6, 7, 8 damage. That's it.
He loses.
I guess I have to trade into thing. I can leave him with 11. And then he's got the Arcane Golem for lethal, probably, right? All right. If I do Unleash and Direwolf Alpha, it's the same thing as Muckless Champion.
The thing is that he'll get Leaper now, so he will have enough damage anyways.
Oh, that's true. Mm. So there's no way out, huh?
No.
I'm not playing around Druid combo. Man, that sucks, man. Emergency cooling. Screwed by the spare part RNG.
Alright, let's go ahead. Hop wants to go watch the Chromagus game, the one that...
He just got Faceless on a Chromagus and then Wild Growth for 2 cards and then still played a Rock.
Holy moly.
I don't know how much HP they have. Is there 18? Is he dead?
No. 18.
Oh my gosh.
Wow. What are the odds of that happening?
15.
I mean, Raynad can tap
into
lethal.
How does he get her Chromagus?
Yeah, both players.
Faceless.
No, I can't.
Oh. Both Chromagusing evil hecklers? Oh.
Guess I should have traded with the King Crush then, huh?
All right, so I guess Amaz wins this one with Fire Bat.
Amaz
3-0 carrying Archon. Zalay 0-6.
Amaz is such a god.
Playing supposedly the worst deck on his team.
What do you do here?
Dude, I beat Amaz's deck.
You played Amaz's deck?
Yeah, I beat it.
Oh, you beat it.
Our team won, what, 6 total games? Kind of sad.
It happens, don't worry.
Yeah, just double trade into it and just double taunt, right?
Yeah, play whatever.
Yeah.
You can play Mistress of Pain too.
Yeah, yeah, play Belcher, Imp Gang Boss, Mistress of Pain, double trade into the 6-8.
Do it.
Yeah, yeah. We don't need more cards right now.
What about second taunt?
Nah, I think I like getting the value on the table.
Yeah.
I can see your pain. Whatever, I'm gonna play it out for pride. Give me Pit Snake.
Pit Snake doesn't even help.
Never lucky.
Pit Snake doesn't even help.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I like to believe, you know?
Yeah, I like to believe. Believing is good sometimes.
Right.
Yeah, I can see this. We'll play. I can
see. Alright. GG.
Okay. Well, we have ourselves a second place finisher of the group. It is Tempo Storm narrowly defeating Archon. Yeah, it was a little bit facetious, but it's okay. The idea is that Archon really tried their best. He even said it in their team comp saying, you know what? I think we actually did pretty good relative to the hands that we were dealt, the decks that we got. I have to agree. I think a lot of the decisions weren't exactly obvious, and they made some really powerful plays, specifically Amaz and crew, on some of those turns to swing back that one game against the
The first game was pretty nuts, that Blizzard top deck. I didn't even think of it.
Yeah, Amaz went 3-0. And, you know, some of that comes down to also Amaz was always the last one to finish playing. So by the time it went, got to his turn, he had both of his teammates helping him. I'm not sure how much that plays into it.
They said that they would go on, they would help the other two decks because they thought the other two were stronger.
The
and then
ones.
Amaz would just do his turn last.
You guys missed it.
What happened?
Rainhead shook Amaz's hand. Oh, my God. It was missed out to Shroom. No!
I said it, so it's proof it happened right now.
He's saying it.
He denied it.
No!
Oh. What an opportunity wasted. But it's okay, we get another opportunity to see a great matchup, Tempo Storm versus Team Liquid. Thank you so much for joining us, Hafu.
Thank you for having
me. Do you have any
me.
Last words before we send off to the commercial break for our finals?
Shout out to the Arena community, and sorry I let you guys down.
Oh, yeah. But okay, we'll try to see if we can get you again next time. For now, guys, we're going to go to commercial break. When we come back, it is the time for the grand finals between Team Liquid and Tempo Storm here at the Red Bull Team Brawl.